Have been destroyed. Ruin, destitution, hunger stalk the helpless victims of the cruel aggressor. But in their darkest hour comes a light of hope, a light that must grow stronger and will grow stronger. It is the hope of American agriculture. Though this nation must fight to keep invaders from its own shores, its farmlands are abundant, greater even than the areas of Norway, Sweden, Denmark, Spain, Portugal, France, Switzerland, Great Britain, Poland, Czechoslovakia, Belgium, Holland, Yugoslavia, and Greece. And spread over this vast land are the farmers, their wives and their children. 30 million, twice as many as the Axis has soldiers. Grim farmers with sleeves rolled up, ready for sacrifices. These embattled farmers are armed. Their weapons are the panzer forces of Food's battle line, farm machinery. Battalions of combines, regiments of trucks, divisions of corn pickers, potato diggers, planting machines, columns of milking machines, and all these machines kept in repair by farmers and their sons under the stress of war. These farmers pouring out bumper crops to fill many a bare cupboard. The farmer with his wheat crop for this year, 52,800,000,000 pounds of wheat. If all this wheat were made into flour, there'd be enough to snow under the entire German panzer army. Looks to me like another Russian winter. Or if all this flour had been baked into bread, there would be enough loaves to build an Egyptian pyramid. And another, and another, and another. Placed a mile apart, they'd stretch the length of the Suez Canal. Supposing this flour had been made into spaghetti. Look at the sweater you could knit. Just a snug fit for old Mother Earth. Corn, 2,850,000,000 bushels. If all this were grown into one huge ear, it would make a bridge from London to the Black Sea. And that hangs right over your head, Adolf. Soybeans, 160,000,000 bushels. Ground into flour, it would make a loaf that would fill Red Square in Moscow. And it has double the nutritive value of meat. Potatoes, 30,000,000,000 pounds, just about twice as high as the Rock of Gibraltar. Some potatoes. Here we have the Matterhorn in Switzerland. And this year's crop of tomatoes, 1,800,000,000 pounds. Vegetables, all kinds of them. There'd be enough to cover the wall of China. 1,000,000,000 bushels of them. Yes, and we're producing vitamins and food concentrates packed with enough power to bowl over the Axis nations. That was vitamin X, boys. Just to mark the spot. Fruit juices. Billions of gallons. If pressed from our fruit crop of 35,000,000,000 pounds, there would be enough to keep old faithful Geyser gutting for nearly 4 months. Or if all the fruit were made into one enormous pie, it would measure 25 miles in diameter. My, what a time a pie thrower could have with that. Milk. 125,000,000,000 pounds of it. If all this flowed over Niagara Falls in a steady stream, it would generate enough electricity to light every factory in New York for 1 hour. And besides, we'd have enough to give our children free milk with school lunches. Or should we churn this milk into butter? War-flooded fields of Holland could be reclaimed by dikes it would build. And if made into cheese, it would make a piece equivalent to this much of the moon. Just imagine a fire made from 4 volcanoes the size of Vesuvius and a griddle 500 square miles in area. That's what it would take to broil the 30,000,000,000 pounds of meat American farms are producing. This little girl grown plump on a diet of our 11,000,000,000 pounds of fats and oils would outweigh 100 super dreadnoughts. And what's more, she'd black out all of Berlin. American hens are busy too, laying 50,000,000,000 eggs. If all these were made into one huge fried egg, it would cover all the United States and Canada. And don't forget, we have enough bacon to go around it. And here come the pigs, 100,000,000 strong. Just think of it. 2 pigs for every person in Great Britain and Ireland combined. Who's afraid of the big bad wolf? Not the farmer of the United States who works and sacrifices to fill the holds of victory ships. Ships turned out by men and women working night and day. Ships that must be fought through dark oceans where submarines lurk. Ships guarded by aircraft, more and more of them. Ships protected by the blasting fire of men of war. Ships loaded with food for freedom, produced, fought through, and delivered to all who fight for the freedom of speech, freedom of worship, freedom from want, freedom from fear. Under this insignia is shipped food that will win the war. Public enemy number one,
Anopheles, the malaria mosquito. Wanted for willful spreading of disease and theft of working hours. For bringing sickness and misery to untold millions in many parts of the world. This tiny criminal is linked to the destinies of man in a cycle of disease transmission that could not exist without either man or mosquito. Each is solely dependent on the other for the existence of the dread malaria. Anopheles is readily distinguished from other mosquitoes by the fact that she stands on her head at an angle of 45 degrees or more. This newly hatched female has not yet touched human blood, therefore does not contain malaria. But if we follow her, we'll soon learn how she becomes a malaria carrier. Like all thieves and killers, she works best under cover of darkness. Locking and barring doors and windows will not keep this hungry prowler out. She can enter through a small crack. What will she find to steal here? Only a little blood, which this man, racked with the chills and fever of malaria, will never miss. Assuming her typical angle of 45 degrees or more, she injects saliva to make penetration easier. And in a few seconds, she begins to feed. But this man is sick. Along with his blood, she's drinking in the parasites, which cause malaria. Gorged with disease-laden blood, she makes her way to some cool, dark place, where she will rest for several days and digest the blood. Although the blood is digested, the disease parasites are not harmed in any way. On the contrary, they multiply to great numbers. Hungry again, she flies out as evening falls in search of blood. This time she carries with her the malaria parasites with which she is infected. Enjoying the peace and plenty of the home he's worked so hard to build, this man is healthy and happy. Little does he suspect he's to be the victim of this bloodthirsty vampire. Again, saliva is injected to make penetration easy. But this time the saliva contains malaria parasites which enter the bloodstream. She dines on healthy blood, and in payment leaves the chills and fever of malaria. In all probability, this man will not die, but neither will he truly be alive, for he'll be continually in poor health, unable to work and keep up his farm. Slowly he will lose all he has worked for. His crops will rot in the fields. His buildings and fences fall into disrepair. His livestock will be neglected, and he'll be unable to earn the money to feed and clothe his family. Multiply this man's tragedy by numberless cases all over the world, and we have millions of dollars lost, as well as untold misery for the victims. And all because of this tiny criminal, which has assumed the proportions of a monster. Are there 6 or 7 people in the audience who will volunteer to help us combat this evil? Good. Well, thank you, men. But before we can attack the enemy, there are certain facts we must know. The first and all-important fact is this. The Anopheles mosquito must have water to lay her eggs in. These eggs float about and soon hatch into larvae or wigglers, which lie parallel to the surface where they feed and breathe. In this larva stage, the mosquito is easy to control. After 7 to 10 days, the larva becomes a pupa or tumbler and can still be controlled. But once she emerges from the pupa as an adult, she can slip through our fingers and become a menace to human life within a mile of her birthplace. All right, men, now we can begin to fight. We can start by cutting the weeds where the mosquito lays her eggs. This makes it easy for the fish to get in and eat the wigglers. Spraying oil on the water is a sure way of killing mosquito larvae of all kinds. The oil enters the breathing tube and promptly kills the wiggler. Those are wigglers, Dopey. Give them the oil treatment. That'll kill them. Dusting with Paris Green is an effective way of killing wigglers and is economical for covering large areas of water. A thin film of Paris Green is strong enough to kill the wigglers without poisoning the fish. Mosquitoes must have water to breed in. These pools will always be a menace to our health unless we drain the water away. There's one way of doing it. Even this hollow stump can harbor mosquito larvae. Say, that looks like smoke. Let's go in and see. Attaboy, Dopey. Spray all the dark corners and under things. You'll find mosquitoes where you least expect them. Yes, we've got to kill everyone in the house. The permanent way to get rid of breeding places is to fill them with dirt. If you want to keep the rain barrel free from wigglers, let's put a screen over it. By covering the cracks in the walls with building paper, we can keep mosquitoes out. Anything that holds water for a few days is a likely breeding place for mosquitoes. And we can't afford to take any chances. So we're going to bury these cans. To be safe from malaria, we must put screens over all the doors and windows. Screens can save you a lot of misery. Attaboy, Dopey. Killer, good and dead. To avoid being bitten by anopheles, we must put netting over the beds. Then we can sleep in safety. Don't let her get away. She's a killer. Yes, even the small cracks in the floor must be sealed. And so we leave them to enjoy their well-earned rest, free from the annoyance of mosquitoes, safe from the dread malaria. Contrast their peace and happiness with the misery and sorrow of this unfortunate plague-ridden family. These people have lost everything simply because they failed to take a few easy precautions. Remember, there is only one cause of malaria, the mosquito. Destroy the mosquito and you will wipe out the disease. Then, in place of sickness and poverty, there will be health, safety, and happiness.
Mystery, danger, fifth column activity. Aha, secret weapons, deadly formulas. These are the forerunners of invasion.
Say, what kind of an invasion is this? Why, it's just a bunch of kids in a doctor's office. What do you suppose they're up to? Uh-oh. Well, now, these floors are kind of slippery. It's a doctor's office, all right, but these kids aren't sick. No, sir, they're here to fight. To fight the oldest invasion of all... Invasion by disease. You see, they've come to be vaccinated. Of course, this is Tubby's first vaccination. He won't admit he's afraid, but he is a little worried.
Well, I guess it'll be okay. What do you suppose this vaccination business is, anyway?
Say, that must be the needle. Boy, it sure looks awful sharp. Hey, I'm not going to let him stick that thing into me.
It's easy enough to see that Tubby doesn't quite appreciate what we're trying to do for him. I think we ought to take things a little slower right at the start here and let him in on the idea. Explain to him what vaccination really is. And while we're at it, why don't we get the rest of them in too so they'll understand what's going on when it's their turn. It's nice of you gentlemen to drop in like this. As a matter of fact, we were just going to call you anyway. You see, the doctor's going to tell us a little story. a story about vaccination. He's going to show us just what goes on inside our bodies when we get sick, and how vaccination will help us get all set to fight off diseases even before they can sneak up on us. Now, in the first place, your body is a whole lot of separate parts, all brought together into one wonderfully organized machine. It's like some big city with a lot of separate buildings or factories. For instance, the heart is the central office for the distribution of supplies to the other buildings of the city. And the blood is really made up of many little workers, which the heart sends to the different factories. Come along over here a minute. We'll show you some of these little workers in person. Of course, we can't show them to you while they're traveling around in your body doing their work, but you can see them sitting still on this glass slide. First, we'll spread them out thin so as to get a good look. There. Now you'll see for yourselves what we've been talking about. You see, what you've always thought was just a sort of red liquid that popped out of your finger when you cut it is really much more. It's actually millions of little workers with a job to do. The job of keeping us alive. Looks like Rags here has a little bloodhound in him. Well, let's get back to our story of vaccination and see where we go from here. Let's see now. Here we are. We're just going to tell you about our veins and arteries and how they're like the roads and highways of the body. Because it's through them that the little workers get around to the different organs or factories and do their jobs. Remember, we said your body is really like a city, a model city, in which everything runs smoothly and will continue to do so as long as it's left undisturbed. Undisturbed by the invader, disease. You see, the wall around this city has a gate through which supplies of raw materials must be taken. Suppose, for example, that you're loading up a new stock of groceries. Bread and butter, lots of jam on it, ice cream and cake. This busy, peaceful city never heard of the invader. But look, the enemy. It's a deadly disease germ, all right. Oh, but there's only one. What harm can he do against the millions of little workers? Just watch him. Suddenly there are two. Then four. Then there are eight, and more to come. Now we understand why diseases are so deadly. It is because they have the power to transform themselves quickly into gigantic, menacing hordes. He doesn't look so harmless now, does he? Before you know it, they multiply themselves into millions. Invasion. The alarm is sounded. The workers pour into the supply buildings to arm themselves, but there aren't enough weapons to go around. And it's only with guns that the invaders can be conquered. There is nothing to stop them here because the body is not prepared. Frantically, the factories are converted to the manufacture of the all-important weapons. But they are far too slow. And as the ranks of the invader multiply with terrifying rapidity, we see that it is already too late. This city is blacked out forever. Yet it could have been saved. You see, boys, this city, or rather this man, died because his body did not have arms and ammunition. Or in other words, powers of resistance against disease. He was not prepared. And he was not prepared simply because he failed to take advantage of the greatest weapon against disease that medical science has to offer. Vaccination. Great men in all the countries of the world have struggled year after year, even given their lives in order that we might live. Jenner, Pasteur, Koch, and many others have worked to create this harmless little fellow who will protect us. He doesn't look like much, does he? But wait until you see what he can do for us. First, we have to get him into the body, and that's where vaccination plays its part. In vaccinating against the deadly smallpox, for example, an ordinary point like a darning needle presses sideways against the skin, letting in a few of the little helpers. But the lookouts inside the body do not know that these little fellows are harmless. They see their wall being attacked and strangers entering the city. And to them, it's a real invasion, and the army marches forth to battle. But in this case, there's nothing to fear from the weak, make-believe invaders. Nevertheless, the factories of the body immediately go on an all-out wartime basis. Production zooms steadily upward. But this time the armies of the body
plants have all the time they need to produce arms and ammunition. They work day and night, 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, building the weapons to fight disease. Meanwhile, the soldiers are easily routing the harmless artificial invaders, and soon the battle is completely won. But look at the tremendous supply of arms and ammunition that the body has made for itself because of vaccination. We're ready for the invader. Let him come. Now, suppose you should catch some deadly disease right out of the air itself, because eating isn't the only way the invaders can enter. They fly around on tiny dust particles or little drops of moisture. They're apt to be all around us, anywhere, anytime. But if you've been vaccinated, you don't have to worry, because your body is prepared against the invader no matter which way he chooses to enter. Here they come, airborne troops launching their deadly attack. They're sure of themselves, confident of their power. But brother, they've got a real surprise in store for them this time.
As if we have a customer already. Now we'll get a chance to see just what vaccination really is. The vaccine, or as we have shown it, the little helpers, comes in a glass tube. We clean the tube with alcohol, and then we clean the arm. Next, we break the tube to allow the vaccine to come out. Then, we put a drop on the arm and painlessly press it, not scratch it, into the skin. That lets the little fellas in, and that's all there is to it. Well, okay, what are we waiting for? Shucks, he knew there wasn't anything to it all the time. Let's go, boys, start building those jeeps. I should have had this done long ago. Shoot it to me, Doc. I've had an invasion of fleas for years. Well, here they come. Wasn't half as bad as having your ears washed, was it? And yet those few minutes in the doctor's chair have made it impossible for the invader to attack. For these boys are now prepared. Inside each one, a powerful defense army has been mobilized, ready and waiting. B for vaccination and victory. Victory over invasion.
Corn is the symbol of a spirit that links the Americas in a common bond of union and solidarity. The exact ancestry of corn is a matter of doubt. Corn as we know it today could not have existed in the wild. Many scientists believe that it developed from teosinte. which has a tassel like corn, but unlike corn, the ears grow in clusters and are composed of a few kernels arranged end to end instead of growing on a cob. Others believe the ancestor of corn was a plant resembling modern gamma grass. This plant had several tassels which contained both male pollen and female seeds. The lower part of the tassel contained the female seeds, shown in red, and the upper part contained the male pollen, shown in yellow. In the course of evolution, the tassels at the top produced only male pollen. The tassels on the branches, only female seeds. These branches shortened, and their tassels were enclosed by husks. Later, the tassels developed into a crude ear. This early ancestor of corn grew on the sunny slopes of the high Cordilleras many centuries ago. Its glistening pods went unnoticed by the roving hunter, for he was intent only on his search for game. The Indian lived on what he could kill. To eat and sleep was all that he asked. As long as game was plentiful, he lived well. But there were times when game grew scarce. The search for food drove him far and wide. Wearied and hungry, he resorted to eating roots. But that was not enough. It was then that the waving tassels of grain drew his eye. He had now found a practical solution to his food problem. And so, through his discovery of corn, the civilization of the Americas began. With a crude clamshell hoe, he dug the earth, planted his very best kernels. An offering to the corn gods was made to ensure an abundant crop. At every harvest, he selected his finest ears for seed and blessed them in the sacred waters of salt, which he believed improved its growth. Because corn was so vital to his existence, he erected great temples to the corn gods. The civilization of the Mayas was built around the growth and worship of corn. Yumkash was the green god, patron of growing corn. An amazing calendar was developed by the Maya to chart his planting and harvesting. To the gods who held the four corners of the earth, this symbol for planting was dedicated. The Maya planted four grains to the hill. And today, many farmers still plant four seeds to the hill. One for the blackbird, one for the crow, one for the cutworm, and one to grow. A few centuries later, the Aztecs rose to power. Their great civilization, too, was built on corn. Cintiotl was their corn goddess. Huatlicue was Mother Earth. Human lives were sacrificed to her that their blood might increase her fertility. In the Andes existed one of the greatest civilizations of the ages, the Incas. They farmed in terraces far up the steep mountainsides. They worshipped the sun god, on whose bounty they depended for their precious corn. They developed corn with giant kernels, three times regular size. Corn migrated into the Argentine, Brazil, across the Rio Grande, far north into Canada. Corn was carried to Europe by the conquistadores, to North Africa by the Barbary pirates. Corn is grown along the Danube, the Nile, in South Africa, India, China, a vital force in the economic life of the world. Corn is our heritage from the Indian. From its golden kernels, we make tortillas, enchiladas, tamales. He gave us corn bread, hominy, succotash, corn mush, forerunners of cornflakes. He taught us the joys of eating popcorn and roasting ears. From the Indian, we learned to ferment corn. The skill and patience of this early ancestor created a new civilization. To him we owe much. Today we plow a dozen furrows at a time, plant many acres in a day, pick and husk by machine. We do in 15 hours what the early Maya required 500 to do. Much has been learned about corn, the most important of which is inbreeding. Now, to accomplish this, a paper sack is slipped over the tassel. Then transparent bags are placed over the ear shoots before the silks emerge to prevent pollinization from other plants. When the silks are out and the tassel is shedding, pollen is released into the sac covering the tassel. Now the bag is removed from the ear shoot, and the sac containing pollen is slipped over the ear. In this way, the silks are fertilized with pollen from the same plant. This is known as inbreeding. After each generation of inbreeding, the resulting seeds produce smaller corn until a pure strain is reached and sizes remain fixed. This may seem odd to deliberately produce smaller plants, but just wait and we'll see what happens when two unrelated inbred strains are joined in wedlock. My, my, what a child! Stronger stalks and increased yield, making better seed corn for bigger crops. Of the total production of corn in the United States, 75% goes for feeding livestock, cattle, sheep, horses, mules, and hogs. More hogs make more little pigs, and more pigs make more little sausages, and vice versa. Corn increases the cream content, builds up little calves. Surplus corn fattens the feeder from the range more economically than any other crop, converting him into choicest beef. And they love it, too. Just watch. Yes, sir, corn has what it takes. And now comes the chemist, who has discovered and developed many products from corn. The kernel consists of two main parts, the endosperm and the germ, from which oil is extracted, furnishing salad oil for your table, cooking oil for your kitchen. From the endosperm, the chief product obtained is starch. Starch used in making ice cream, pudding, pies like mother used to make. And starch that stiffens your shirt. Starch makes sizing for textile, paste for the bill poster, and mucilage for postage stamps. From starch comes glucose, rich golden syrup, for cornbread, griddle cakes, jams, preserves. In surgery, glucose replaces sugars lost from the blood. Starch makes sugar, the sweet tooth of the corn. Quick energy as candy. It's the body and flavor of your soft drink, the boost in your beer. Corn sugar is one of nature's most easily assimilated foods. Doctors prescribe it, babies cry for it. As science scans the glass of the future, it sees new vital uses for corn. Alcohols for power fuels, high explosives. Tires from corn. Fabric for parachutes, better than silk. Plastics, tougher than steel. For cars, for tanks, men of war, and ships of peace. Farm machines. And streamlined trains and buildings of the future of plastic, monuments to corn. It's a far cry from those primitive days when the waving grain attracted the roving hunter. Little did he realize the store of riches they contained. The botanist called it Zea Maize, that which sustains the Mayas. How much more truly might we say today, that which sustains the world?
Picture of you. So who will volunteer to help us? Won't someone stand up? Ah, that's fine. Suppose we choose this man here, and the rest of you may sit down. Just stand still a minute, friend. There now. You can sit down too. And now, let's get on with our story. A story about you and your worst enemy. Now, you have already learned to protect yourself from many of your enemies. For instance, you've learned to wear clothes to protect your body from heat and cold. You've learned to grow fine crops. And you raise pigs and chickens. These things all protect you from the enemy, hunger. And if a storm should come, you find shelter in your house. Where you've learned to protect yourself from the weather, too. But even your house won't protect you from your worst enemy. An enemy who may be here in this room right now, hiding in the dark corners, lurking in the most unexpected places. A great unseen enemy, deadly and silent, ready to strike in an instant, ready to attack you without warning. No, 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 wait. It's no use running away. No one can run away from disease. Yes, that's right. It's disease that is your worst enemy. For disease can be anywhere, in the air you breathe, in the ground you walk on. Or, hey, wait, don't drink that water. Disease can be in water, too. Yes, I know, it looks clear and pure. But you see, disease is caused by tiny living creatures. Creatures so small you couldn't possibly see them. This water may be full of them. But here, let's call on a man who knows all about these little creatures. The doctor. He studies disease every day by using a very wonderful instrument, the microscope. Now, there's nothing mysterious about a microscope. It's just an instrument to make things look bigger than they really are. But suppose we show you how it works. If you don't mind, Doctor, we'll borrow your glasses. Thank you. And, oh, just a minute, Mr. Fly. We're going to look at you through the doctor's glasses. See? These glasses will magnify. That means they will make the fly look bigger than he really is. But let's try a stronger magnifying glass. You see? Now the fly looks even bigger. If we use two strong glasses, the fly grows larger again. And if we use three, or even four glasses, the fly begins to look like a monster. Here, let's look at his leg. Why, his leg is covered with hair. And so, through our magnifying glasses, we're seeing something we've never seen before. Now, if we take these four glasses, put a tube around them, we have a microscope. Simple, isn't it? And yet, by looking through this instrument, we can actually see the tiny creatures that cause disease. All right, let's try our microscope on some of that water you were going to drink. This little piece of glass has a drop of that water on it, and we're going to look at it through the microscope. Come on now. Everybody, watch closely. There, see? The water is full of tiny living creatures called microbes, the deadly little enemies that cause disease. Now, perhaps you wonder how these tiny microbes can harm a big, strong person like you. Well, just look at this giant tree, tall and sturdy and strong. You'd think it would take something mighty big and powerful to hurt this great tree, wouldn't you? But let's get real close. Do you see this little beetle on the trunk? Just watch him. See? He's boring a hole in the bark. Well, one tiny beetle certainly can't hurt a big tree like this. But suppose we go inside and see what it's doing. Look at that. The beetle's drilled deep into the wood and laid its eggs. And now look. The eggs have hatched. And the young beetles are boring more holes and laying more eggs. Then there are more beetles, and still more, until, finally, there are thousands of beetles, all eating away at the life of the great tree. Now the tree becomes sick, and before long, the tree dies, killed by tiny enemies much smaller than itself. Now, let's suppose you drank some of this bad water. If we could look inside you, we'd see that the microbes are carried down into your intestines, like this. And now we can watch the little enemies begin their deadly work. At first, there may only be a few of them. But see what is happening. The microbes are growing fat as they eat your body. And as each microbe grows larger, it splits and becomes two. And these grow and split again and become two more. Now the microbes multiply by the thousands, just like the beetles in the tree. Soon your body would begin to lose its strength. And before long, you are a very sick man, all because of these tiny microbes in the water you drank. But remember, it isn't only in water that we find these little killers. No. With our microscope, we can find microbes almost anywhere. Suppose we take a look around your farm. What's this? You have no latrine? You use the cornfield? Well, remember we said there were microbes in the soil? You see? Here they are. The vicious, deadly killers that live in soil foul with human waste. But these microbes are not only in the field. They may be right inside your house. Let's go inside and see. Well, there are some flies on the table. Now, you may think that flies are harmless, but let's look at the fly's leg through our microscope. See? It's covered with filth. If we look closer, we see the filth is full of microbes from the field where you left your waste. And when the fly walks across your food, he'll leave thousands of these deadly killers behind. But microbes can be found in other places, too. We see that many people sleep in this room, and one of them is sick. Well, this is where we find microbes in the air. Microbes that came from the sick person's lungs. And now, as the others breathe, they draw into their bodies the disease that is in the air. If we look around, we may find other microbes in this room. This is the Anopheles mosquito. Our microscope would show that this Anopheles mosquito is full of malaria microbes. And when the mosquito bites you, it will leave many of these microbes in your blood. Then you will have the disease the mosquito carries. Yes, it's true that disease can be anywhere, and you must protect yourself against it. You must fight it. How? By attacking disease before it attacks you. First of all, build yourself a latrine. That way you'll destroy the breeding place of disease and the flies that carry it. Cover your food so the flies can't get at it. Cover your bed at night. Then the mosquito can't reach you, and you'll be safe from the disease the mosquito carries. So we have seen that there are many kinds of microbes. But remember this. They are all living creatures. Therefore, the microbes themselves can be killed. For instance, the microbes we saw in the water can be killed by boiling the water before you drink it. The microbes that live in dirt and filth can be killed with soap and water. So wash yourself regularly. The sun will kill microbes. Fresh air is your friend, too. So let's put windows in your house. And let the sun and fresh air come in and help you. Now that you know what disease is, you must fight it wherever you find it. Protect yourself against it, and you will make your life healthy, happy, and prosperous.
Every living creature must eat to live. An ox, as we all know, can do very nicely on nothing but grass. There are other creatures on this earth that require a diet of meat, and only meat. While still others prefer vegetables and fruit, always the same food. Well, that's all right for them, because they only need one type of food. But here's Careless Charlie and his family, who are also trying to exist on one type of food. No wonder they're in this run-down condition. They don't know that man is different, because man needs a variety of foods to be healthy. Yes, it's true, they do eat plenty of good beans and cornbread. Still, they are not well-fed. You see, these foods, corn and beans, are both the same type of food. And man needs three different types of food. So, in addition to corn and beans, he needs some animal products. And a third type, vegetables and fruits. Why? Well, simply because each fills one of the three main needs of the human body. foods are muscle builders. Vegetables and fruits build sound bones and teeth. And grains and roots give energy. And the combination of all three builds resistance against disease. Oh, yes, you have big muscles, too, but look at where they are. No, Charlie, the only road to good health is to eat the correct foods. And you can raise these foods right in your own yard. Well, Charlie took this good advice, and now things are very different. With the help of his family, he raises, in addition to corn and beans, some animals. He also grows a good variety of vegetables, and he's planted some fruit trees. The soil now produces the necessary three types of food. Animal, grains and roots, and vegetables and fruits. And this delicious stew, which contains all three types of food, is now a very popular dish on Charlie's table. Is it any wonder, then, that this family is today the picture of health? Compare this health-giving variety of foods with their old one-food habit. But our friend is not careless anymore. Today he's known as Careful Charlie. Yes, one person here deserves special credit. And that is, excuse me please, Mrs. Charlie. Because she always tries to include in their meals some of each of these three types of food. Now, for muscle building and strength, she depends on the animal products. Chickens are easy to raise, and they're a delicious dish. Eggs, too. They're an excellent food. Hogs will eat everything. And besides good meat, they provide lard and fat for body warmth. Cows or goats provide good, rich milk. Milk is a very important food. All growing children must have it. In fact, milk has been called the perfect food. These animal products, plus an occasional fish, go largely to build muscles. Now, to use our muscles, we need energy. For energy and endurance, we can always count on the second group, the grains and roots. The usual corn and beans, potatoes, sweet potatoes, plantain, peanuts, and sugarcane. A wide variety of energy foods which help us do a day's work and not be worn out. But how far would we get without a sturdy frame? So, for straight, solid bones, we must eat plenty of the third type of food. Vegetables and fruits. That's why Mrs. Charlie wisely has fresh vegetables and fruits growing every day of the year. Cabbages, tomatoes, carrots, peppers, pumpkins, green beans and peas, whatever's in season. And fruits, papayas, bananas, oranges, avocados, mangoes, apples, an almost endless assortment of the third group of foods, which is so necessary for the building of good bones and sound teeth. The lives of growing children are so often ruined by weak bones. When by eating enough vegetables and fruits, this handicap could be avoided. And so remember, it's the vegetables and fruits that help us to have strong bones. And since we need strong muscles, we must have muscle-building foods, animal foods. And then we need energy foods, grains and roots, so we can move and earn a living. Yes, it's this same plan, a plan of eating the three necessary types of food, that keeps our friends in fine health. And the soil has rewarded Charlie for his carefulness and efforts. For the soil will respond generously, rewarding those who work it, providing an abundance of foods to fill all three of our body's needs. But let's not forget, it's the combination of all three that builds protection against disease. Indeed, we can all learn a lesson from careful Charlie and his wife. For by eating the correct foods, they are now enjoying life. And they have given their children the priceless gift of good health.
Each one of us is equipped with the ability to think, known as reason, and the ability to feel, known as emotion. Within the mind of each of us, these two wage a ceaseless battle for mastery. Of course, in the undeveloped mind of a child, there is only emotion. Let's go inside Junior's head and watch emotion at work. Aha, here he is. He's got the whole place to himself. He can do as he pleases, because reason isn't born yet. Meanwhile, emotion is complete dictator in his control over the child.
Pull the kitty's tail.
Emotion loves adventure and excitement. So he says,
"Let's go down there. Don't be scared. It'll be fun."
So Junior starts down. Emotionally upset.
Who are you?
I'm Weezin. Had I been here sooner, this would never have happened.
Oh, yeah? Well, just remember, I'm the boss around here.
Time will tell.
Well, the battle for mastery is on. And so Junior grows up into an average, normal male. Time has brought about many changes inside his head since childhood. Reason seems to be in the driver's seat, with emotion under control in the rear.
Oh, I hate being tied down all the time. Let's hit the high spots.
Now, just control yourself. When I'm driving, there will be no nonsense.
Oh, gee whiz. I want to live dangerously. Woo! Look at that. A classy dish, huh?
Well, she's not bad.
Hey, slow up. Let's get acquainted with this number. We'll just go up and I'll sit.
Now, we must maintain proper respect for womanhood.
Oh, they like the rough stuff. You're not gonna pass that up.
We certainly are. Now, sit down and behave yourself.
Could I go for that? Here, let me handle this. We're going places. Woo! Hi, babe. Going my way?
And that's what you get for not listening to reason. It served him right, young lady. Oh, by the way, may we borrow your pretty head for a moment? Thank you.
You shouldn't have slapped him. He was cute. You want to be an old maid?
Please, remember, we're a lady.
Oh, a lady. I'm tired of sitting around being a lady. Let's have some fun. I know. Let's eat. I'm starving.
Well, I'm not really hungry, but we might have something light, like tea and toast.
I want a club sandwich and a giant double milkshake.
Oh,
and...
gracious, no. Think of our figure.
You heard me. A club sandwich with potato salad.
But I insist. Tea and toast.
A four-decker club sandwich with cheese and ham and tuna and chicken and mayonnaise.
No.
We get chocolate ice cream with whipped cream on top and a cherry.
Remember, we're on a diet, please.
And for dessert, I'll have chocolate layer cake with fudge icing.
Oh, dear. It's so good.
Oh, in the name of hot fudge icing.
And here again, you have the evidence that uncontrolled emotion can cause you a lot of trouble. Now, in these strenuous times, it is more important than ever that we control this conflict between reason and emotion. Let's take the case of Mr. John Doakes, who tries to keep up with current events.
Tonight, the news is very grim. Looks bad, folks. We're going to lose this war, but not very careful.
Hey, you know what I just heard? I heard the subs are sinking all our boats.
I heard on the radio the other night. I got to miss that because you got to be 40 years old.
I'm not 40. The major told him.
The enemy is landing with heavy tanks and guns, and I'm afraid they're going to move right in.
A friend of mine was at Pearl Harbor, and he said... Extra, extra, read on, I found it.
Taking all our food and sending it to Europe. While we starve to death, starve to death, starve to death, starve to
you
death.
You can't go to work without tires and gasoline.
He's got the right dough.
Don't believe everything you hear.
We're losing. He said so.
Don't be stampeded by hearsay.
I'll believe anything I want to.
You must use judgment and guard against...
Oh,
that's right, Emotion. Go ahead.
Control yourself.
Put reason out of the way. That's great. Fine. For Hitler... That master rabble-rouser destroys reason by preying upon the weakness of emotion with fear, sympathy, pride, and hate, just as he did in the minds of the German people. Behold, the Nazi Superman. Let's see how Hitler controlled him through fear. Fear of the concentration camp. Fear of the Gestapo.
Oh, I'm scared.
Don't listen to that madman.
Now, through sympathy, by crying, I only want peace, but they forced me into war.
Don't cry. He is a big liar.
Don't call my Führer now. The whole world is against our peace-loving Führer.
Germany, aber alles.
Now, it's pride. Pride in phony racial theories about Aryan superiority.
It's all childish nonsense.
Shut up. Here's a genius and a great leader. Heil Hitler. Come on. Heil Hitler.
Heil Hitler.
Ja, hatet England. Pfui auf dein
Hate.
England.
Hate for the free, democratic way of life.
This is madness.
Down with the democracies. Sieg Heil. Sieg Heil. Sieg Heil.
Yes, it's madness. Reason has been enslaved, while emotion is the master. A mad emotion, stripped of all reason, leaving nothing but ruin in its wake. So you see, fellows... For us, there is but one answer. You, Reason, your job is to think, to plan, to discriminate. And you, Emotion, to be a fine, strong emotion. An emotion that loves his country, his freedom, his life. And together, you must be grimly determined.